Hello, for wonderful beings. It's Gage here. Welcome to Real Talk. And I got a special guest, Melissa, who also has the gift of autism.
Hey.
Welcome. I'm so happy to have you on here. And we were talking in the earlier, talking about like you didn't get diagnosed, but you kind of had signs of when you're growing up.
I did. It all started when I went nonverbal at about 3 or 4 years old. I was learning everything just like everyone else for 2 years. And then when I turned 3, all of a sudden, it all disappeared into a black void, a black nonverbal void. I didn't talk, and I would do this. The only thing that would get me out of that was my parents getting on the floor with me and making silly, funny noises and saying, my dad would say, horse's batootie. And I would then start laughing. Yeah, I was a pretty gross kid at that time. I had pretty gross humor.
Oh, that's hilarious. It's interesting, just those things that would get your concentration.
And since I was born, I always wanted to fit in as well. When I was 4 and 5, I did start talking, and my very first sentence was, "There's a scarlet tanager out in the yard." I was obsessed with reading all the bird guides, and I memorized all the bird species almost perfectly. And the most amazing part of it all was not only was that my first sentence, but I identified them correctly. Pretty sure it was a him, given his bright scarlet colors.
Wow, that's incredible. And that's the awesome thing about autism. Like, it's a gift, you know, especially when you're really laser focused on something. It's like it just works automatically. It's like our brains are like almost computers where it's just like.
To this day, people say I have an excellent memory, and I was very hyper focused on things back then. I had a laser focus, was very motivated, and could work on the same thing for hours. I would also make up cute little words, like the main one that I said a lot was Fiaco, which meant friend.
Wow, that's impressive. Yeah, and you mentioned that you were really fascinated with the oceans, like you were really interested.
Yes. I had many hyperfixations. My first one of all was birds. Then came dogs. I wanted to read all the dog breeds. I also looked at the dictionary and the thesaurus, and I memorized not only the words and their meanings, and what page they were on, and I ended up having an amazing vocabulary.
And that's why, like, I've talked to a few people with autism, and that's amazing saying, like, certain sayings you can memorize a lot, and the brain works. It's very, like, even the graphs, like, you look at a regular brain versus an autism brain, the autism brain's lighting up a lot more than the regular brain, and that, I think that should be an example, like, man, this using it the right way, the autism can be one of the most powerful tools you can have. It's just
absolutely. Absolutely. And I learned so much. And then my probably most noteworthy obsession, hyperfixation, was fish in the ocean. My family had fish tanks since I was very young. We had freshwater fish, and I loved going to the pet store and collecting these fish and helping with the, you know, choosing the fish that would go in that tank. I became so obsessed with fish that I learned all the different species and sometimes even their species names, and I could tell you everything there was to know about a fish if I saw it in the aquarium or fish store.
Wow, that's amazing. And it's a lot. It's not like just like 10 species or anything. There's a lot. There's like hundreds.
Yes, I'll definitely say I did not get to every one of those hundreds, but I got to many of them. And then we had a saltwater fish tank, which I greatly enjoyed as well.
Wow, I love that. The ocean I've been really interested in because it's very mysterious. I feel like it's more mysterious than the land animals, like the deep sea. We still haven't discovered even half of it.
Did you know that only 5% of the ocean has been discovered?
I've heard someone say that. I was like, that is insane.
But that's crazy. It shows that here it's so vast, but yet it's not even all of it.
No.
But it was thanks to my mom. She encouraged my hyperfixations, and also she would work on everything with me involving communication, speech, English, like all my weak points, until she would work on everything with me, homeschooling until like 6, if not 9 o'clock at night. And I thank her for that. I hated it back then, but now I thank her for it because she helped me overcome so much.
That's amazing, Harry. Your mom sounds like an amazing person.
She is. She's a very amazing person.
Yeah, when you have these people in your lives, it means a great deal because a lot of people have judgments or don't think you're good. Or they put your expectations so low, it's like it hurts you, you know? So when you have
certainly
people that can bring you higher.
Certainly. That was my dad's side of the family, the latter that you just said. So I was 12, 13, and my parents had an extremely nasty divorce. An extremely nasty divorce that needed to happen, but was really bad. My dad was and grandma never felt I was good enough. They taught me a lot about masking. They encouraged me to mask. And it gets a lot worse, even. So, my dad would a lot of times, like, I would appear to be not listening to him or not listen to him because of my poor short-term memory associated with my being autistic. And also, you know, I would do the typical teen things, of course. And I struggled a lot in school and I had meltdowns and stuff. And he would get upset with me, but seem really mean when doing it. He would throw things near me, but not at me. And it was very scary. And I would confront him about it. And he would say just simply that he has to discipline or I won't grow up to be a good kid or stuff like that. But one of the most memorable incidents was I wasn't even doing anything wrong. I was just venting to him about something, and he started banging on the steering wheel saying, "You're just a basket case." And he would have this thing where he was like, okay, it was like I would do that after he had a long day at work. "Why do you always have to do that? Why do you always have to do this during a long day or after I've had a long day at work?" Then I would strategically start doing it on his days or days off, or talk about anything I needed to talk about or whatever event about on his days off. And then he would be like, "Why do you always have to do this on my day off?"
Yeah, it's when someone's close to you, it's really hard to, and you don't even realize it when it's happening. You're like, man, this person isn't healthy for me. Especially, I feel like a lot of people with autism, they're very kind and they're very loyal to those close to them. So we don't always see what's going on around us. When they're closest to us, they can do like very awful things, and we would still look over it because we would look at the good side of them.
Yes, but that's what I did for years and years. I looked at the good side, and I didn't pick up on the cues that he was a really bad person in a lot of ways. And not only that, like, and even all the things, like, I would tell him how stressful living with him and certain issues he had was, and how stressful it was sometimes, and he would just say, well, don't you think you caused it? You need to consider what part you contribute.
And that sounds like a very narcissistic relationship.
He's a narcissist.
They all take responsibility and they blame others. And they say when you're in that type of relationship, there is no way, no matter how hard to try, no way for it to be peaceful, you know, because I'm dealing with relationship. Like, I look at these things, I'm like, is this what this is? Because I don't like living over and over and over again. You know, it actually brought me to a very depressed state, or at a point I didn't even want to live anymore. You know, it's, you can't allow yourself to get there. You got to look out for yourself, number one. You know, you might want to help that person because they're close to you, but ultimately you got to look out for yourself. And especially being autistic, we can very much overlook things and put others before ourselves.
Yeah, that's what I did too for years. And the only, like, what got me to now be at peace and be disconnected from them, you know, and find my own peace is simply just my phone having died and been dead for 3 weeks. And then I realized how peaceful it was not having to talk to him and how much better my mental health got overall.
I'm really glad to see that. Sometimes it can be really hard to let that go, but my mom told me this a long time ago, just because they're with you on your journey doesn't mean they're going to be with you in the long term. You know, they're not
right.
They're not supposed to be with you in your entire journey. Sometimes they're only there for a short time to help you grow in some ways, even during the hard times.
Right. He makes like he did so much for me. So the good was he did pay for my college. I now have 2 degrees. I got my bachelor's degree at Troy University. It went in 2019. And then I got a master's degree from the University of North Alabama in curriculum and instruction in 2022.
Congratulations. That's amazing.
Thank you. Thank you.
That's awesome to hear. I actually never went to college. I didn't really know what I wanted to do, and I was still kind of figuring out my own thing. And during that time, that was actually when I was really depressed. So I wasn't even thinking about college. I was just looking forward to get through the next day. But for me, if I was going to college, it had to be something I knew I was going to do. And because it's a lot of money, you know, if you're going to spend that much money, you got to be almost 100% guaranteed what you're going to do. And I really just got my purpose in just really speaking on behalf of the autism community and bring more acceptance. There's awareness. Everyone speaks of autism awareness. Everyone's very much aware of autism, but there isn't much acceptance. You know, there's a lot of judgments and even a lot of parents saying it's a burden to take care of the kids. You know, I understand that. It can be a lot, you know, because kids with autism can be very difficult than normal children. But regardless, you took on the responsibility as being a parent. It doesn't matter if they're autistic or whatever diagnosis they have. You know, when you're a parent, you take on that responsibility no matter what they're going through. So, you know, I believe it's bringing more acceptance and realizing these kids have gifts. You know, I mean, what they have is not a burden. It's not something to be here, but something to be praised. And like, hey, you can do anything you want to, as long as you put your mind to it.
We all have amazing capabilities in us.
Yeah, I'm excited to, like, I just want to help them realize that gifts, you know, because a lot of autism people, a lot of them are struggling right now because they don't have a lot of people that are like, man, you can do anything you want. You know, this, you don't have to be like everyone else, because you know what? I tried to masking. Yeah, my parents were very, they tried to help me. They didn't push me to do anything, at least bad-wise, like masking or anything like that. They were very supportive. But growing up was very difficult, because going to school, I was judged. You know, I was looked down upon, and I was bullied a lot. And when I got home, you know, it was very difficult, because my parents at that time were going through a very nasty divorce. And I always got in the middle between us two, and I just, like, I was having a very hard time. Because even at home, I was
also in the middle, caught in the middle between them. But my mom was, she's amazing, and she's much more understanding of my differences, even though she doesn't consider them necessarily to be autism.
Yeah, it's always nice to have someone supportive like that. Yeah, my mom, me and my mom, they have the greatest relationship. When we got over, we're very, because she was going through her things, you know, she was going through a lot of relationships, because you still come and navigate things. And I would get angry at her, like, mom, like, who are these guys? And like what, like, you're not here when I need you to be here. Like, she was there, but not really mentally there when I needed her. And I was like really struggling. But also she was, you know, I didn't realize how much she was going through. And our relationship definitely took a hit for a while, you know, until I got older and I started asking her questions about what she's going through. And once I was able, after I wanted to end my life, I asked for help. My brother really helped me a lot. You know, if it weren't for him, I don't think I'd be here. And I took these programs from a life coach called Tony Robbins, and it changed my life, where I was able to get myself help. I was almost 300 pounds at the time, and I'm like, right, I'm going 3 years ahead to now, almost 4 years, I'm like 240. So I've overall probably lost like 50 pounds since that. So it's, my life rapidly changed, and I was able to use my gifts in a good way. Because for a long time, I thought autism was a curse. You know, I'm sure others felt that the same way, because we're looked at like, oh, you don't have a high expectancy. You can't, well, as far as like going far in life, and they're like, this is how far you can go. What you have is it's unfortunate thing to happen at birth. I'm like, no, this is not how it is, you know. It's not something to be pitied or judged. It's something to be
right,
be amazing, you know. Like, you can do anything you want. And a few people in my life, they believed in me. My parents, my brother, and my best friend, he passed away a couple years ago, but I'll never forget what he, how much love and praise he gave me. Because I didn't have much love for myself, and he, you know, I could always see my pros. I always saw my cons, and my best friend T always said, "Gage, you can do everything you want. Anything you want, you can do." And he just believed in me, and I could tell the difference. He wasn't just pitying me; he believed in me as a friend, and he was there, you know. And to this day, people would say, oh, family's blood, but I don't believe that. I believe it's the relationships you have with people. T was a brother. You know, he's my brother, and he didn't have to be my, he wasn't my blood. You know, he's my family, and that's where he made a big difference in my life.
That's amazing. I've had some amazing people who made a difference in my life as well. And I was the same way. I also felt ashamed of my autism, because I was also pressured to mask, but now I realize that masking really only hurts your mental health if you do it too much.
Yeah, and you don't always have to mask, you know. It's, and who wants to be normal? I mean, excuse my language, but fuck normal. Like, I don't want to be like everyone else, you know. I'm actually,
me neither.
Yeah, how bored would that be? Hey, man, what did you do yesterday? Same as you, dude. Like, that's fucking boring. That's like, there's no
very boring.
Yeah, that's the best thing about being weird. You know, you learn so much from that person.
I love how weird you are.
That same here, you know. It makes the conversation better. I always enjoy it. It's just, especially talking to people with autism, it's always very, it's like, for the first time, I really felt like, okay, I wasn't the only one that went through this, you know. It's, And that's why, like, this community, the more I get deeper into it, the more, like, it makes me feel more whole, honestly, you know, because I feel we're very all connected.
Yes, I feel very at home in the autistic community as well.
And I feel like, honestly, you know, I felt like something's calling me, and honestly, being a leader of the autism community is something I want to do, because there's still a lot of work that needs to be done, because there's a lot of people that don't really accept autism. They're aware of it, but it doesn't mean they accept it. They look at us like we have a disease. Even I think it was one of the presidential person. I'm trying to think of his name now, but he was basically like, oh, autism is something that needs to be cured. I'm like, that's not really how it works, man. This didn't come from a shot. This is what we're born with, you know? And it's not even something to be ashamed of, you know? It's something to be, like, amazed about. Like,
autism. It is.
And it's still something we're learning about, you know? But from experience, having autism, I wouldn't be who I am without it. And, you know,
I wouldn't be either.
No, and I feel, and you and me are pretty awesome people, I would say. So it's definitely not a bad thing. And masking, I don't believe in that anymore. You know, a long time ago, I tried to do that, but it wasn't who I was, you know. I couldn't do it if I wanted to. I tried. It didn't last long, though, because it just wasn't who I was. Now, there's always small sample sizes. Maybe we do it unconsciously because we kind of grew up kind of doing it, but it's more about being yourself.
It is. When you mask, people don't really love you for who you are, and then you end up making all these fake friends who love you for your mask.
Yeah. Yeah, I a lot of friends.
And expect you to mask all the time, and then turn sour if you show any autistic traits.
Yeah, when shit gets real, they're not there. You know, the friends I have now compared to what I used to, and not saying it's bad for them, but it's just they're going through something different, and they didn't know who I really was. And my friends I have now, they know who I am, and it's a very new experience. And life is so much better. You know, before I didn't see, like, the best way to say it was, like, I didn't see colors before I really started being myself. When I started to accept, not listen to everyone else, because I listened to what everyone else had to say, but when I started listening to what I wanted to do and who I wanted to be, I saw the colors of light in the world again. You know, the colors of the trees, and life is the best right now. You know, there might be difficult moments, but overall, I wouldn't change a thing. You know, everything I went through made me stronger. Even how painful.
I agree. I feel that everything I went through made me stronger as well.
Yeah, you went through a lot. You know, I couldn't.
I did.
It was a very difficult situation, but you're very strong, you know. A lot.
Thank you. You are too.
I appreciate that. Thank you for sharing. You know, that it really touched me, because it's very difficult, you know, especially when someone you're close to. It can be hard because you want to help them, but, you know, that's just who they are.
And my goal is also, the reason I really wanted to do this podcast is that I want to spread awareness, and more important than awareness, acceptance. And I would love to help people who have autism and disabilities and special needs to move ahead in life just like everyone else and have the same opportunities as everyone else.
I 100% agree. You know, it's autism is a gift. I think we just need to learn how to use it. You know, it took me a lot of work to even have my brain, my brain would over-sync, and I couldn't make out sentences, and I would have a hard time talking to people. Like, I was very social, but sometimes I would sync too fast, and I'd be in the future or this, and now I feel a little bit more calmer, and I'm able to slow things down, where I can not, because I would talk too fast or this or that, because my mind's running a mile a minute, but when you take a breath and kind of stand still, I can do things a little differently. And now I can use my gifts in the best way. And that's
awesome.
My goal is to help others. You know, and the autism community is the biggest community I want to help because it's the one that's struggling the most, in my opinion. You can see it, you know. I don't think it's talked about enough, really. Because a lot of people are struggling, it's because we don't have a lot of acceptance. You know, it's there's some autism communities that are really not there for autistic people. Like, I'm going to say autism speaks. They're not there for the people. They make videos that, like, basically dehumanizes us. Like, they're like, oh, autism is a dark voice. Like, autism is the most awful thing, man. Look at those kids. They're having fun at a playground. Like, that must be awful. And they're like, even this one lady's like, oh, you know, like, it made me want to drive over a bridge. It wasn't for my daughter. I'm like, this is sick. Like, it made me really fucking upset. Like, I was like, this is not autism, man. And the fact that they didn't really apologize and kind of just moved on, I was like, this ain't right, bro. Like, I don't care if they're one of the best organizations ranked. I know, like, you made that video. It showed me who you really are. You know what you're really about. You're not here to help autism. What their original goal was, they never said anything differently. They want to cure autism. They don't really want to help. You know, with curing autism, you're basically the same way with disease. Like, imagine how that makes us feel. You know, they...
Right. They just... People who say that just aren't considerate of other people's feelings.
Yeah, they're trying to make autism and us that for number one. You know, autism is who we are. It's a big part of who we are. And if you're saying that, then you're calling us a disease. You know, it's how I felt about it. And it's, they like, oh, we don't have emotions. But like, we process emotions differently, but we still feel, you know, and that.
Right.
So for me, I want to really bring awareness to people about these organizations and lead them to organizations that actually do care and want to help.
Yes, I do. I want to do the same. It's hard finding organizations that truly want to help, though, and share our values.
Yeah, I actually found an organization. They have a daughter that's autistic, and they had a lot of struggles, but they're really building something special. It's honestly incredible. It's called NeuroShifts.
NeuroShift?
Yeah, it's near where I live. It's like right in Tampa. It's like where I'm currently residing in. And it's incredible. The organization, I've talked to her a few times, and I love what they're doing. And it's one of the few organizations that I actually want to help. And I want to start investing more. I want to invest more into communities that are like that, that really want to help, that don't just say they're helping and use not even half that money they get to help them. You know, because you look at the money at NeuroShifts, but Autism Speaks, they don't use a lot of the money for actually people with autism.
You know, right.
I want to invest in many organizations that help and expose the ones that don't help and that are putting on a face like they do care. I actually made a video about it. I was hoping it would explode, but it never happened. But, you know, whatever I can do to help others and to make them aware of organizations you should not put your faith into, I will help. I'll do my best.
Yes.
But it was amazing having you on. I always, I talked to you a few times before. I'm really glad we got this going. Cause I know there's a couple.
Me too.
But yeah, thank you for coming on. I'm really grateful to have you on.
I'm really grateful to be on here.
And you're welcome anytime. You know, you're always a welcome guest here.
Yes.
I hope you guys enjoyed this video. And for those for autism that are watching this, I hope we brought a little gift to you or anything you can learn from this. We love you guys and have a blessed day. Love you guys.